Hello. You might have heard that the world is steadily becoming better and better. That the annual number of war casualties has plummeted 90% during the last 70 years. Or that global child mortality has seen a tenfold decrease since the beginning of the 19th century. You might also have seen visualizations like this one, with a per capita income along this axis, life expectancy along this axis, and all the different nations represented by bubbles where color and size mirror the continents and the number of inhabitants. And you might have seen how all nations during the last two centuries have enjoyed an ever-increasing lifespan and more earnings to buy things. What you've seen is true. These are facts that can't be denied, and they do say something important about the world. Today, however, they are being used for propaganda purposes, to justify the existing state of affairs and hail Western capitalism as the ideal society. Both politicians and scientists do this, and they do it by emphasizing some facts to the extreme while completely ignoring other facts. Take a look at these bubbles, for instance. Is this really what the world looks like? Look at the US, at all its inhabitants, neatly packed in this small little bubble. Why is it so small? Because it represents the mean values of income and lifespan, not reality. In reality, all national income is unequally distributed. So among the bottom half of the American population, the average income is $16,000 per year, much lower than the national average. For this half of the US, income has remained roughly the same for four decades. So why does the national average income increase? To understand, we have to look at the entire distribution up to the top 1%. And to do that, we have to zoom out a bit. Among the American top 1%, the average income is $1.3 million. Now, listen carefully. Since the share of all national income going to the top 1% is almost twice as large as the share going to the bottom half of the population, whatever happens up there has a huge impact on the national average. And so, during the last 35 years, the top 1% has more than tripled its income, while the poorest half of the population has remained just as poor. That's why national averages can be so misleading. Inequalities like this affect how long people live. An American woman belonging to the top 1% has an average life expectancy of 89 years, whereas an American man belonging to the bottom 1% has an average life expectancy of 73 years, about the same as in Bangladesh. Mind the gap? Yes, they have a gap at about 16 years, and the US is not that exceptional in this respect. If we zoom in on Sweden, where I come from, a relatively egalitarian society, you can take the Stockholm tube from the well-educated inhabitants of Danderyd to the less educated inhabitants of Vårby Gård. This trip will only take a few minutes, but when you arrive, life expectancy will have dropped 18 years. All this is going on beneath the national averages. But even if we look at national averages, it is far from evident that industrial capitalism produces better and better living conditions into infinity. If we look at the UK and the US, for instance, average life expectancy has actually gone down during recent years. Not because the rich are dying earlier, of course. What we see is an increase in so-called deaths of despair. That is, deaths caused by suicide, alcohol, and drug overdoses. Despair, you might ask. Yes. That's something else that is rarely mentioned whenever the health benefits of economic growth are promoted. Have you ever heard any of these advocates of capitalism talk about mental health? After all, looking at the entire world, the leading cause of ill health today is not a physical illness, but depression. About a tenth of the global population suffer from it, and all in all, so-called mental disorders account for about a third of disability worldwide. So why would anyone interested in global health want to ignore this particular type of suffering? Here's why. This is the world of depression. The redder a country is, the more its inhabitants are suffering from depression disorders. As you can tell, the most depressed populations can be found in Europe, Australia, and the US. This is the world of anxiety. Here you see the same pattern. Lots of anxiety disorders in the Americas, Europe, Australia. Not so much anxiety in Africa and Asia. Strange, isn't it? It looks as if the richer a nation is, the more problems it has with people being anxious and depressed. But wasn't economic growth supposed to save us from our misery? Now, I'm going to show you all the eating disorders in the world, all the anxiety disorders, all bipolar disorders, all depressive disorders, all drug abuse disorders, all alcohol abuse disorders, and all the schizophrenia. This is how the global burden of disease, that is how much people are suffering, is distributed among high-income nations, upper-middle-income nations, lower-middle-income nations, and low-income nations. Yes, the richer a nation is, the more its inhabitants are likely to suffer. And there you have it. The reason why so few talk about the global distribution of mental illness is because the pattern doesn't fit into the notion of economic growth as a panacea to all human problems. Nor does it fit into the notion that the world is becoming better and better. During the last 25 years, both poor and rich are actually suffering more and more. You can measure this in several ways, but it doesn't matter whether you look at medical records or ask people about symptoms in national surveys. Or if you consider the consumption of antidepressants, which only in the so-called developed nations belonging to OECD has doubled in only 15 years. All numbers point in the same direction. That doesn't mean that economic growth necessarily makes us unhappy. No, it can definitely make us happier when some material necessities in life are satisfied. But once the growth reaches a certain level, its effect on our well-being tends to weaken. If we look at the US economic growth since 1972, for instance, it has more than doubled. Yet according to the most reliable surveys we have, the happiness of Americans has remained roughly the same and even weakened somewhat. This begs the question why economic growth should be endlessly pursued. But even more fundamentally, one could ask if health of any kind is relevant when assessing the merits of a society. Let's have a look at these bubbles illustrating the average income and lifespan again. This time, I've highlighted some of the world's dictatorships. Look at them. Look at the very fast progress they all make. How Singapore even outshines all Western nations on both income and lifespan. What does this tell us? Do these nations also represent good societies? Is it preferable to live in Qatar than in the US, where people, on average, are poorer and die earlier? If we zoom in on China, we see that life expectancy grew spectacularly fast between 1949 and 1976. This is one of the fastest growths in life expectancy ever registered, contributing to the fact that in less than 30 years, Chinese life expectancy more than doubled. During this period, China was also governed by Mao Zedong, one of the worst dictators history has ever seen. What does this tell us? That Mao's China represented a good society? Not counting the Great Famine here in the middle, where at least 15 million people died in vain. Does it tell us that it's good to live in authoritarian communism, where those who criticize the ruling elite risk their lives? If not, why is this kind of statistical cherry-picking acceptable when it comes to demonstrating the benefits of capitalism? Maybe life expectancy and other health measures are poor indicators of what kind of society we live in. Maybe we shouldn't only look at the society as it is, but also consider its potential, what it could be. Regardless of how you see it, though, the world isn't only becoming a better place. In many respects, we see the reverse. I've mentioned mental health problems, but the increase in inequality, housing shortage, and precarization of the labor market also deserves our attention. Pretending as if these problems do not exist is dishonest and a glaring example of poor social science. These problems can be solved, but they need to be acknowledged. To exclusively proclaim the perpetual improvement of the world is not going to help. Shouldn't we say something about global warming?